Good afternoon and welcome to all the participants. It gives me great pleasure to be present at this inaugural lecture series of the Center for Urban Policy and Governance of the School of Habitat Studies. It's a matter of privilege that we are opening this lecture series with a talk on a very important theme of land, housing, and property rights. And what better way to do this by listening to the story of a unique mission, the Jaga Mission, from the very person behind this mission, Mr. Mati Vatnan, Secretary Housing and Urban Development, Government of Odisha. And we are also privileged to have Professor Mukhopadhyay with us as the discussant. We thank the Omidyar Foundation for supporting this lecture series. Dr. Kundu has laid out the focus and the theme of this particular lecture and the lecture series, and also to talk to us about what might be the flavor of this particular lecture and how it might get discussed. So I don't have much to add, but I know that the importance of land and housing cannot be emphasized enough as essentials for the well-being of people. Everyone has a right to a safe shelter and means of livelihood and overall sense of security through access to land and property. And in most parts of the world, access to land and property give a lot of sense of security to people. The SDG 11 highlights the need for affordable public housing in our cities that are such an undesirable confluence of extreme affluence on one hand and extreme poverty on the other. This situation is accentuated several times over in several of Indian urban centers, and we know about that. Most often these themes are discussed in the post-conflict context, such as whenever there are wars or riots and other calamities that force people to get displaced, resulting in the loss of housing and land or property ownership. But actually such calamities are not the only reasons, and we know that that these are not the only reasons for people's struggles for rights to home, land and property. Migration and development induced displacements also lead to these issues, particularly in the life of urban informal settlers who perhaps leave behind some land and house in their village to migrate to cities for economic reasons, and then live very precarious lives in the urban settlements without a decent shelter and in the perpetual fear of losing the land and property back in the village. I'm reminded of the 1953 Bimal Roy directed Hindi film, The Dhobi Ka Zameen. Some of you may have watched it, in which the protagonist migrates to Calcutta as he struggles to save his small piece of ancestral land. Without that land, he knows his family will face acute hardships and starvation. But even otherwise, even if they have not migrated, the poor who live in our cities face a very, very difficult situation when it comes to affordable housing, and their conditions of living have been discussed over and over again. But we had never thought that the urban informal settlers face such acute housing and shelter issues. In the COVID context, the plight of the urban poor has come into even more sharp focus in the country. Living in conditions devoid of the most basic civic amenities of water, toilet and sanitation and other hygiene issues, and very, very compact living conditions. The war against the pandemic has been that much more difficult for them. In Mumbai and many such urban centers, we know that the slums have been facing the acute hardships and the full onslaught of the pandemic, even as we have seen this happening in places like Dharavi or many other slums across the city of Mumbai. So transforming slums into livable habitats with basic infrastructure and amenities, which the Jaga Mission has achieved, is a laudable and remarkable feat. And I'm very happy to see that this particular lecture series is opening with a very important theme and a very important mission. And I'm sure Mr. Mati Vatnan will share with us how this was done and how it happened and what was the inside story as the lecture title says. So welcome once again to everyone, and thank you for involving and making me a part of this lecture series. I look forward to listening to Mr. Vatnan.
It's very difficult to remember all the formal addresses, and thanks Professor Bharat as well for inaugurating the series. It's a lot of encouragement to us. Thanks for that. And I mean, I cannot say but how privileged I am to chair this particular lecture. I mean, for a long time, I think in the country, especially for the last 20 years, where especially in the field of housing, informal settlements, one has seen a constant hurling towards a real estate-led economy, which whose ill effects one is seeing on settlements day in, day out. But one is kind of looking for hope stories in some ways. And I think really, even when we saw the BSUP stories in Odisha itself, the things which were happening in Bhubaneswar, things which were happening in Puri, and the kind of impact that some of the formal housing and rehabilitation was having on the slum dwellers, one kept on feeling, here are cities with so much land, here are cities where the privileged keep all the resources to themselves and are very, very unwilling to share even precarious resources of land with the, in some ways, have-nots or the little haves, I should say, more clearly. And I think it is in this context that one looks at the Odisha Act, which was passed in October 2017, and the kind of programs that the Jaga Mission has been able to build, because it is not just a matter of transferring land rights, individual, non-transferable, inheritable land rights to slum dwellers, but it is also a matter of giving them dignity. It is a matter of recognizing them as human beings and then building livable habitats. It's an immense challenge, I think, and it takes a man of uncommon courage, grit, I would say, and persistence to take many of these challenges on. The concept of giving land rights has been spoken of in the 1960s and 70s through the Patta Acts in some of our cities. It has been repeated and experimented only as a concept under Rajiv Awas Yojana, which largely remained as a pilot. But I think to implement it, the resistances that perhaps Mr. Mativatnan has encountered are for him to tell us. And I think what we are looking forward to is really an inside story into this aspect of policy making, implementing, and staying with it. I'm sure there must have been other ambitions. So prizes and incentives such as the Habitat Prize, I think, are only a small part and are only a small incentive. Right? So I think what keeps him on? What are the challenges which are internal to the policy-making environment? What are the challenges which are encountered at the implementation level within the political economies of cities? I think it is really, one is looking forward to hearing this. And it has been so inspirational, Mr. Mativatnan, that I see that the Punjab Act, which has come up today, or even the Arunachal Pradesh now comes up with an act which gives property rights to slum dwellers. I do hope if these turn out to be larger examples which other states which are real estate led, I would say, also learn to live with. And I'm so happy that Mr. Mativatnan is here to deliver the lecture, because I think he has been the one who has envisaged this, taken several thoughts within this and built multiple kinds of partnerships. And it's not easy for an IAS officer to do that. In my view, IAS is one of the most colonial practices that we have ever had. And he is perhaps one of the most non-colonial persons. And use of power in a good way is interesting. We also have an extremely distinguished discussant, someone who closely understands issues on the ground, processes, as well as a larger view that economists always bring in also on the table. So welcome to Professor Mukhopadhyay as well. We are privileged to also have you as a member of our Board of Studies. And I'm really happy that both of you are here. So over to Mr. Mathivatnan. And so we will have Mr. Mathivatnan's presentation first, followed by Partha giving his comments, and then we will open up to a larger discussion.
I'll share the screen, share the presentation. Visible? Is it visible?
Yes.
I'm audible now?
Yes, you are.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thanks for the opportunity. I was looking for a physical interaction in TIS campus. I'm deprived. I'm sad about it, but I look forward to have a full-fledged, happy event sooner to be there with all of you in your TIS campus. And I'm very happy to present the Odisha's experiences in Jagam Mission. There is nothing like inside story, outside story. There is only a story. Only thing is that this kind of webinar gives an opportunity to share the finer details, the micro details, which we have encountered in the implementation right from policy making to the implementation process. It's on. We can move forward.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Give a background of Odisha for the people who are not very, very much aware of Odisha. Odisha is in the eastern coast, one of the eastern Indian states, having 7 million population living in the 114 urban areas. About 1.8 million live in the slums, which means about 1/4 of the urban population lives in slums. There are three categories of the urban areas: smaller, medium, and large corporations. We have about 2,919 slums in 114 urban areas with about 4.12 lakh households with, as I said, 1.8 million population. We are aware of the slums having no security of tenure, poorly built, temporary tenements, mostly on the vacant land, unused wastelands, mostly located near a livelihood center where they can get employment opportunities. The habitats are without, you can't call it as an habitat, the settlements are without adequate sanitary conditions, no drinking water facilities, hygienic condition is very poor. The slum dwellers who live in those pitiable slums, deprived places, they contribute to the informal sector. They are part and parcel of the city's life. They made the cities, they are making the city, and they operate the city. Without them, the city cannot operate. Realizing their contribution in the city's making and the city's functioning, the question before us, as before everyone, what do we do with the slums and the slum dwellers? Should we evict them or should we empower them? So this question has been with us for a very, very long time. So on one fine evening, the chief minister called us to discuss about this. And then in few minutes, we have been discussing this with the Honorable Chief Minister. And on that day, Honorable Chief Minister's office said, I think we should go ahead, come back with the act. So it was September 27th or 28th, sorry, September 15th or third week of 2017, September. So within a week's time, we went back to them with a draft bill and then the contours of the act intervention policy, which was immediately okayed by Honorable Chief Minister. Then we went ahead. on August 8th, Honorable Chief Minister convened the cabinet where this historical decision has been taken to settle land rights in situ basis in favor of the slum dwellers, recognizing all the slums in the state in one stroke. And after the cabinet, historical cabinet meeting, Honorable Chief Minister himself has briefed the media, and these were his lines, words. "Today we had a cabinet for the people who are the lifeline of our cities and towns. They are the silent ones who keep our homes secure and comfortable. It's because of their sacrifice and hard work that the kitchens run, the gardens bloom, the city breathes, and we feel secure. Today's decision will be setting a benchmark for the entire country." These are his words. And here I would like to mention that I am also the secretary in charge of the parliamentary affairs for the past almost 10 years. 10 years I have been doing the cabinet meetings, Council of Ministers meeting. And this is the only meeting, only cabinet meeting so far, which has been convened with a single agenda. Most of the cabinet meetings will have more than a dozen agendas, run for hours together. This is the only cabinet meeting where this was the only agenda. Only for this item, Honorable Chief Minister thought that we should have a special cabinet meeting. It was convened with this agenda. And then this is the only cabinet meeting in my memory, my experience, I can say, that Honorable Chief Minister himself has decided to brief the media. Otherwise, the briefing is done by a senior minister or by the Chief Secretary of the state. This is the only meeting where he himself thought that he should talk to the people through the media. And these are his words. And the philosophy behind it is that the state values the people more than the land. The moment you talk about urban land settlement, people will say that the urban land is expensive, cannot be parted with. So that means the people are they don't have any value directly that implies. So these are the features of the act. It's a very small act, very powerful act, very impactful act. The strength of the act is that though it is very small, very brief, till today it has not warranted any amendment. Not even a single amendment has been made so far. That's the strength of that's the effective efficacy of the act. So the act provides for in situ land settlement in favor of the slum dwellers, recognizing that the slum dwellers are part and parcel of the city and they have a right over the place where they are living. So in municipalities, we have made a differentiation. The land right has been conferred only in medium and small towns. For the time being, we have left the major corporations, 5 corporations. So in municipalities, maximum land that can be settled based on the occupation is about 484 square feet. In NAC, where the land pressure is not much, where these were earlier villages, now they have become municipal areas. So the land has been allowed till 646 square feet per family. And if the land cannot be settled in situ for some reasons, if the slum has to be relocated, then the new place, 323 square feet standard plots is provided. So for the economically weaker section, we call them as urban poor, the land is settled free of cost without any charges. And if they are in occupation of land more than 30 square meter, then 25% of the benchmark value or the notional value or the guideline value or the circle rate, which we call in Delhi, that has to be paid for the part of the land which is in excess of 30 square meter. And in slums, we are aware that we will also have non-poors, not that everybody who resides in the slum is a urban poor. You will always find 10, 15%, 20% non-poor, or earlier they were poor, now they have become slightly well off. So if they don't fall under the urban poor category, then the land would be settled at 50% of the benchmark or the circle rate. And the land rights which are conferred is, the settlement is on the land in actual occupation. The land can be utilized only for the residential or residential cum livelihood purposes for the families. And the land right is heritable, mortgageable for a housing loan, but can't be transferred. the LRC, the land rights certificates are accepted as valid address proof. This is the implementation structure. At the state level, the Housing and Urban Development Department is the nodal department, but we have not kept anything with the department at the state level. We have the act by design itself, we have kept all the powers, all activities at the ULB level, at the urban local body level. Nothing has been kept at the state level. Normally, you will find that the proposal will be sent to the state government for approval, or the cabinet decides, or the departments decides, or the government decides, nothing. We know that if we keep the power at yourself, then nothing will happen. If you want things to happen, it has to be decentralized. Decentralized not to the even to the district level, it has to be to the city level, to the urban local body level. At that level itself, the things have to be decided. Otherwise, you cannot achieve the speed. Then it will result in pendency, accumulation, then favoritism, all those things. So we have consciously, deliberately kept all the activities at the slum level and at the urban local body level within the city. And at that city level itself, we have constituted a committee giving all the powers under the act. There is nothing that the city level committee will not have. So it's called Urban Area Slum Rehabilitation and Redevelopment Committee. It's headed by the district collector, and it is assisted by a scrutiny subcommittee constituted by the collector himself. And below that, we have the Slum Dweller Association. The slum dwellers are organized into an association registered with the urban local body. And that Slum Dweller Association is the main player in this entire act. As I said, the composition of the committee is headed by collector. We have the SP or his representative. We have Tahsildar. We have executive officer. One urban planner is part of that, nominated by the collector. And then the municipal council, since this is basically it happens in the cities, you have an elected council there. So we need to have the representation from the council, but you can't leave it to the elected council to decide. Then it takes a political shape. The city government is a political body. Chairman or mayor is a political person. It can't be left to them. So that's the reason that it was, given to a committee headed by the district collector with police and majority officers. But nevertheless, you cannot keep the municipal council away. So one representative, elected representative, nominated by the municipal council has been kept in as part of the committee. And the collector will nominate one person from the slum dwellers as the representative, and one local NGO, the collector would nominate the committee. If you see the committee, constitution of the committee, it's predominantly collector officials and the people nominated by the collector as part of that, with least representation for the political body. You can say that it's not very democratic, but this approach has worked. It was a deliberate act. And the implementation started in all the urban local bodies with massive community mobilization, participation, capacity building of the machinery, the entire machinery. And we have done a survey of the slums immediately using the drone GIS based mapping has been done. We have engaged local NGOs who have engaged the facilitators or volunteers who have taken up house to house survey with a handheld device with an app developed for this survey 1, 2, 3. And at the household level, the volunteers of the NGO sat with the slum dwellers' families and then collected the entire information, application, their signature, their photographs. Everything is collected at the urban local body, at the household, at the doorstep, the service was provided, because we know that the moment you say that the slum dweller has to apply for it, then somebody would print the application, somebody would invent an affidavit, the advocates would invent affidavit for every affidavit, 500 rupees to 1,000 rupees to 2,000 rupees, depending upon the ignorance level of the slum dweller would be collected, exploited, then the middleman will come into play, then you have to go to the municipal office or the Tahsil office, then brokers will flourish, all these things will happen, then the harassment and all these things will happen. Not to give scope for anything, we said that we have designed the act rules every guidelines, instructions in such a way that the beneficiaries are not required to visit any government office, including the urban local body or tahsil office, not even once till the end. No, from the beginning till now, they don't need to visit any government office. Rather, the government functionaries through the NGOs would visit the household and collect all the information and provide all the services at their doorstep. These are the handheld device with the app loaded, collecting the information at the doorstep. The process of land rights settlement is like this. You have the slum dweller association. We have a slum mapping, the drone agency, a technical agency engaged for doing the drone mapping as well as for preparing the GIS based map. And then we have the NGO, local NGO partner, who does the house to house survey, collect the application information, everything. And the slum dweller association, the NGO assists the slum dweller association to prepare a land settlement proposal. And then the whether the slum is located in a government land or private land, that gets authenticated in the tahsil office from the revenue map. And then the collector forms a scrutiny subcommittee, because the committee with collector, SP and other senior officers will not have time to go through the documents in detail. They form a small scrutiny subcommittee with the tahsildar and the subcollector and the executive officer to go through the documents and find out whether all required documents are provided or not. And then after that scrutiny, then the committee sits and grant the land rights on the basis of the committee's decision. The tahsildar is authorized, or the executive officer is authorized to issue the, tahsildar is authorized in most of the places to issue the land right, and the land rights are issued. So that is the land right certificate. In the process of implementation of this, we realized that many slums are located in untenable lands. Tenable land, untenable land. Tenable lands are leasable land. Untenable lands are presently not leasable. So what do we do with them? So the lands are recorded as forest land. Lands are recorded as burial ground. The lands are recorded as road or water bodies or garbage dump yard. So those lands cannot be immediately leased out. So we need to undergo a process, land classification change process in the tahsil office, which takes time. So till the time, as an interim measure, we introduced something called land entitlement certificate. So though it is not a provision under the Act, Odisha Slum Dwellers Act. So this is our invention to provide interim security till we do the conversion of the land and provide full-fledged land rights. This is applicable only for the slums which are located in the untenable land, which are presently not leasable. The slums located on environmentally hazardous places like, garbage dump yards, the river banks, the railway land, the defense land, the water bodies. So in those places also, since the land rights cannot be settled, we have given the land entitlement certificate. That means the family is entitled. They are the occupant of the slum and they are entitled for the land right, whether here or in a suitable location. That's the meaning of that. And the another very important thing is that once you issue the land entitlement certificate, then it is the onus is on the state to issue the LRC. That means till the time you cannot disturb the slum dweller or the slum. So the progress so far in this process is that 2,777 slums have been drone surveyed and the GIS maps have been prepared. 168,141 household have been undergone door-to-door survey. Applications have been collected. We have their information in digital form. 109 the urban local body level committees have been formed. 2,919 slum dweller association. That means in all slums, we have the slum dweller associations formed. More than 60,000 families. I have forgotten to update this figure. I think now it must be more, almost 70,000 families have been granted land rights certificates in situ basis. And for the untenable lands, slums in the untenable lands, 103,328 families have already been granted with land entitlement certificates so far. So the highlights of this intervention is that the act has been made very simple, unambiguous, very small. The the act is designed, the intervention is designed and implemented in such a way that beneficiaries are not required, as I said, to visit any government or municipal office, not even once. None of these beneficiaries have ever visited any of the government offices. We have deployed drone for the survey mapping, used GIS technology for preparing the map. And we have also, at the same time, we have also engaged a local NGO led by the Slum Dweller Association, took up a participatory process involving the slum dwellers, the beneficiaries in the entire process. That has resulted in a dispute-free, litigation-free process. Though we have done more than 70,000 families have been issued land rights, more than 1,03,000 families have been issued with land entitlement certificates, and the upgradation process is now on. Till today, we have not experienced any major dispute or litigation because of the transparent process, simple, transparent, participatory process we have followed. In the course of implementation of this land right program, we realized that merely just giving land right alone is not going to transform the lives of the slum dwellers. We need to do much more than that. There is a need for 360 degree development of the slums, apart from the land right and the housing support. So keeping that in mind, to transform the slums into livable habitat, Odisha has come up with a mission called the Jaga Mission, a time-bound mission launched by Honorable Chief Minister on 7th May 2018. As part of the Jaga Mission, we moved from phase one was focusing on the land right and housing support under the existing housing programs and land entitlement certificates in the phase one. And after reaching a stage, then we realized that we need to move on to the slum upgradation and livable habitat program. So we took up phase two during the thick of the COVID-19, September 2020. We had an event where Honorable Chief Minister has launched phase two of Jaga Mission, which is participatory slum upgradation and delisting by releasing a standard operating procedure. And the objective is to upgrade the infrastructures and services in the slums to make the slums on par with any other residential area of the city, to delist the slum. Once the infrastructure and services are upgraded on par with any other place, then that place should not be called a slum. So the slum has to be delisted or denotified, and the Slum Dweller Association has to be converted to Resident Welfare Association. So that's the objective, and to mainstream the slums with the rest of the, integrate the slum with the rest of the city. So our target has been, as we always have a saturation basis approach, pan state, 2,919 slums. This includes the municipal corporations also. For the land right program, we have not included 5 municipal corporations, but in the slum upgradation program, livable habitat program, we said that irrespective of the land right, the slum can be upgraded, slum can be converted into livable habitat, even if the land right is not conferred on the slum dweller. So all 2,919 slums have been taken up for upgradation. The target is to transform them into Adarsh colonies or livable habitat in a maximum of 3 years period. And we also had an interim timeline that at least 500 slums should be upgraded and delisted by 1st of April 2021, which is the state formation day in Odisha. That is called Utkal Divas. We wanted to, when we started this program in September 2020, we wanted to have an interim milestone. So we decided that Utkal Divas should be the milestone and 500 slums should be the target. So we are now working on this pilot program. So the process flow we follow in the upgradation process is that we identify a slum, we take up the participatory need assessment, PNA, we call it as PNA, participatory need assessment, involving the slum dwellers, assessment of the basic infrastructures and facilities. The gap is analyzed. What is the desired level of infrastructure and amenities that should be there in any habitat? What is available in that particular slum, and what is the gap? To fill the gap, to upgrade the infrastructure, the slum infrastructure upgradation projects, the program is done with DPR preparation, funding requirements, and the execution process. Then the projects are taken up, funds are mobilized. Then the projects are completed. Then once the upgradation program is completed, all the projects are completed, reaching that saturation level. Then the slum dweller association itself will take up a proposal for delisting it, for denotifying this as a slum, and to convert the slum dweller association into resident welfare association. That delisting process, there is a standard SOP available. And once that is done, then the SDA, if they want, they can change the name of the habitation also. Right now, the slums are named by the outsiders, not by the slum dwellers, as they were called. Many places you would find, in many cities you would find, the slums are called by the caste of the people who inhabit it. In many places it is called Bauri Sahi, Harijan Sahi, Adivasi Pada. They are all called like this. Now, once the slum becomes a livable habitat and then slum dweller association becomes a resident welfare association, then resident welfare association will take up that task of renaming the habitation as they like. And once they rename it by way of adopting a resolution, then the municipal and revenue records are changed accordingly. Here, the beauty is that infrastructure projects which are lined up for upgradation are implemented by the urban local bodies through the slum dweller association. No contractors are engaged. And the slum dweller association, if the work is small project, the engineers implement it through the slum dweller association as an agency, or it is done departmentally and slum dweller association is engaged as an implementing partner. They take up the supervision, and for the supervision they are paid 7.5% as the supervision charges, which normally we pay to a contractor. So when we talk about slum upgradation, what do we mean? Which are the aspects we want to upgrade? How do we say that a slum is upgraded to a livable habitat? So we have, for easy and for uniformity's sake, we have identified these six verticals, six major parameters as the minimum upgradation parameters. We have taken every house should have a piped water supply. Every house should have access to toilet, either individual toilet if they have land. If they don't have land, then an access to community toilet or public toilet in that vicinity. Then they should have, the habitat should have pakka road, mostly paved road. The road should have pakka stormwater drainage. Then there should be a street LED street lighting. We are implementing smart LED street lighting throughout the state, including all the slums. And then the house should have electricity connection. So these are the six parameters, six facilities, six verticals we have identified. So and these parameters should be upgraded to the saturation level. These are the works being undertaken by the Slum Dwellers Association, including the wall painting, pakka road, mostly paved block road, pakka drain with covered slab. We also take up Parichaya. Parichaya is our multi-purpose community center, multi-activity center in the midst of the slum. And we have open space development. These are some of the works before, after. The open space and open gyms created in the slum areas, you will find a tribal aged lady doing this exercise in Keunjar district. Children learning the alphabet from the wall. As I mentioned that we had fixed an interim target of upgrading at least 500 slums to livable habitat before 1st April 2021, which is the Ukkal Divas. And I'm happy to share with you that 510 slums are almost ready, as we are now just 15 days away from the timeline. 510 slums have completed the upgradation process. Now they are undergoing the delisting process, which is expected to happen in the next few days in 19 urban local bodies. 72,000 families are benefited in this, covering a population about 3.24 lakh and 60,506 meters. Because when we talk about upgradation of the road, improvement of the road, if it is a highway, we talk in kilometers. If it is in a slum area, we only talk about meters of road. So it is 60,506, that means 60 kilometers. So drain improvements is taken up with covered slab, 48,242 meters. Water supply projects about 8,812 connections, house connections have been done. Though we have taken up water supply to every household program about more than 2-3 years ago. Now they are under the fag end of completion. Toilets, about 7,000 seats toilets have been done. This includes individual household toilets or community toilets in the community. And 1,073 street lights have been installed in these 510 slums. About 47 crore have been spent in the last 5 months. About 5,000 the SDA leaders, community leaders from the Slum Dweller Association, from the slum community, are involved in this execution of these program, in these projects, either as implementing agency or as supervisory partners. So I was talking about the untenable land the slums are located. Some of the untenable lands can be converted to tenable. If it is a burial ground or water body, which has lost its character long ago, decades ago, the slum has been in existence, but the land is recorded as, the public road or the burial ground, and all those things can be changed, or gochar land, grazing land. Then in urban areas, we don't need grazing land, so it can be straight away changed. The classification can be changed. So those can be changed into leasable, tenable, and then land rights are being settled. But there are certain categories of lands, environmentally hazardous, like garbage dump yard, the flood plains, river bank, where it is not only it is objectionable, but it's also not desirable to settle lands, it's because it's hazardous. So yeah, and if the land is recorded as railway land, on the tracks, you have lots of slums, or the lands of defense department cannot be settled. So in those cases, the relocation is the only option. It's a compulsion. In-situ settlement cannot happen. So only in those cases, we are suggesting for the relocation as an option, and we develop new habitat, which are low income layout, a planned layout with all necessary infrastructure facilities and services, where the individual plots of 30 square meter is made and given to the slum dweller with the land rights and with the housing assistance to construct their own house. The new habitats are under development in several urban local bodies, Kalahandi, Baleswar, Tenkanal, several urban local bodies, especially in the slums which are located on the railway lands. So an SOP has been specific, exclusive SOP has been prepared and notified for the new habitat. The principles for the new habitat is that we need to exhaust all alternatives for the in-situ settlement. Only in exceptional cases where it cannot be settled, then the relocation to new habitat is allowed. And we also try to re-densify the existing tenable slums. If you have a nearby slum and you have space in that, land in that, then this untenable slum, objectionable slum households can be settled, moved there as part of the re-densification process. That is also one of the options. And prior consent of the slum community is taken through a formal resolution of the Slum Dweller Association. It is a must. Without that, we don't take up this exercise. And we leverage the housing schemes available, 2 lakh rupees, 2.2 lakh rupees is given as housing assistance for the beneficiary-led construction. And the plot of land with the ownership is also provided. And it is through incentive and encouragement they are motivated to move. It's not out of force or compulsion. And this is the process we follow in involving the community consent, how the step-by-step process envisaged in the SOP for the relocation. And in the implementation of the Jaga mission, right from phase one to the participatory slum upgradation, delisting in the new habitat program, in all those things, the SDAs also have grown over time. the Slum Dweller Association, which were not in existence, where through the act, we created the Slum Dweller Association, formed it, built their capacity, and made them to participate in the entire development as well as the governance process. This is how the SDAs have grown over a period of time. Now, in most of in whatever activities now we take up in the slum areas, whether under Jaga Mission or under any other program of the state government or the urban local body, the SDA are our partners. They act as a bridge between the slum dwellers and the urban local body and the government. They work very closely with the ward officer, and they have an active role in the participatory need assessment program under the Jaga Mission Phase 2. And they are, in most of the cases, they are our implementation partner. Either they directly implement it or they take up the supervisory role, and they pass a resolution as and when required, especially for the delisting, denotification process. They also manage the community assets, the assets which are created within the community, the Parichaya, the multi-purpose activity center, the open space development, the park, the open gym, all these things. The assets are given to the Slum Dweller Association for management. They are supposed to collect user charges from them, and they are supposed to manage it. And the urban local body also provides annual maintenance for that. In fact, we are in fact developing and graduating the Slum Dweller Association to actually function as the fourth tier of governance below the third tier, that is the elected urban councils. In the slum areas, our Slum Dweller Association. In the non-slum area, our Mission Shakti groups, the women self-help groups, they are actually groomed as the fourth tier of governance to work as to act as a bridge between the people and the elected council. The Jaga Mission and its implementation has got recognition, including World Habitat Award in the year 2019, Geospatial Award for use of technology for the drone mapping and GIS mapping, and the Janagraha 2020 award also has been given to us as the best state. And this I would like to highlight that the World Habitat Award judging panel, after reviewing the project, has mentioned in their ticket that this project has not only established land rights for residents and improved living conditions, but they are doing it at an astonishing scale. This is a fantastic initiative, acting as a superb example for the rest of the country of what can be done. The extreme speed of their progress, backed up by legislation, is very impressive. We were encouraged by these encouraging words, and all these things were possible only because of the strong partnership we have with institutions like Tata Trust, Comedia Network, Kadasta, Spark, the local technology agency, Janagraha, Center for Policy Research, TIS, IHS, they are all our partners, and we consult them as and when required. Some of them are our formal partners. IHS and TIS are our informal partners. We always consult them. And we owe the success and accomplishments to our partners. With this, I end my presentation.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mathivatnan. This is, as is quite evident from the presentation, this is truly a one-of-a-kind kind of intervention into urban housing. Both in its conception and its scale, it is something that is unprecedented within the Indian context and perhaps even within the global context. I'll put my remarks in three buckets. One which sort of tries to highlight which are the key components of the strategy that are sort of supportive of inclusive urban growth. The second, the challenges that would be involved in scaling it up to other states. And third, and related to that, some specific questions that Mr. Mathiratnan can then sort of enlighten us about how these kinds of issues were handled, right? So the first, but before I start anything else, I think the first question, which is on everybody's mind, is the manner in which the politics of this played out and the manner in which the political support behind an initiative of this sort was sustained over such a long period. Perhaps in the discussion, Swatantra, you could address the kind of political environment and ecosystem that allowed for this kind of program to be implemented and the support that you received. And without, of course, naming names, the kind of opposition that you must have faced and the kind of objections that were raised to these kinds of initiatives, because that will help us understand the kind of problems that will happen in the other states as and when the sort of the political settlement changes. So the first thing to recognize is this is in some sense, and I think it's important to flag that it's a sites and services program. And sites and services used to be very much a part of the international agencies plus governments kinds of initiative going forward before it was sort of discarded. What has now become, is now seen as a very successful approach in terms of building sustainable settlements. Now, in this place, there was self-selected land, as Mr. Mathiratnan essentially said, that the land was selected by the people who had settled there. And this intervention came in and provided tenure, services, and financial assistance. So three large components which sort of came in, which helped the people build their own houses. I think doing Jaga without the BLC would have been harder. But I think the real sort of congruence of BLC and Jaga has enabled it to become the powerhouse it has become. The BLC component, the critical element of the BLC component is the incrementality. Once you have provided tenured land, and in this case, I think one of the real innovations is not only the land rights certificate, but also the land entitlement certificate. So whenever there is, while the process is on, the household is not in a limbo, is not an uncertainty, but has much more enhanced levels of tenure, which will allow the household to make investments. So, and this incremental housing obviously can be expanded as household wealth grows. Orissa is a big source of migration, and therefore the flip side is also a lot of migration remittances, especially into these smaller towns. And that would help grow these assets further as it moves forward. And most importantly, especially in these smaller places, it provides well-serviced rental housing. Because as you build these settlements, one of the core issues that people ask all the time is what happens to new slums. And fundamentally, what this kind of approach provides is not only housing for people who are living there, but by enabling the incrementality, by not saying you will get 25 square meters and no more, what it allows is it expands the supply of rental housing in that particular locality and expands it in a manner where the locations are appropriate for that kind of activity. So in that sense, I think the as this program goes forward, we should take a look as to what is happening to the rental markets in these settlements, because I think they will form a big answer to the kind of issues about growth of rental housing in smaller towns going forward. The second thing that I really liked about this is the notion of, and as you can see from the photographs, is public spaces in the settlement. The notion that these are not just about houses, but it's also about habitat. And I think without those public spaces, bringing the community together into a cohesive unit, which is essential if you want, and I'll come to that in a second, the Slum Dwellers Association to succeed, is an important part. The physicality of the space also complements the kind of association that you have tried to put forward with the Slum Dwellers Association. If you want to create a community, you'll have to provide, design the space to have community spaces, which is what I think one of the most important aspects of this particular thing. It'd be useful to sort of take a look at different settlement areas to see whether the role these kind of community spaces play in building cohesive communities. And finally, I think one of the most interesting things is this program, by focusing on smaller cities and essentially for the moment parking the more complex land-related issues, the real estate issues that Amita spoke about at the beginning in the bigger cities, and say, okay, we will come to that, but until we come to that, let us focus on what we can do. And we know that smaller cities are actually quite an economic powerhouse. And the ability to create this kind of communities and settlements within these smaller cities, I think, enhances their economic potential. And I think in that sense, provides for a much more equitable and distributed urban growth form in Orissa. And I think we'll see the benefits of that as we go forward. Two quick questions, I think, which may be useful to get clarity. I think a lot of people will be asking on them. And perhaps one could, Mr. Bhagavatman could address them more specifically in detail, is the issue of renters, as to how they address the issues of renters and whether they were treated the same as non-renters in that sense. And how did that actually, how did the dynamics of that play out? And secondly, the notion of the implementation of these Jaga 2 projects through the SDA, which I know will gladden Chandraj's heart, because this is almost like the duet scheme that he has been trying to push across the board. But it would be really interesting to understand how the skills, and a lot of those projects require a fairly high degree of skills. This is not unskilled labor that is implementing these projects. How these skills were inculcated within the SDA, or how the SDA acquired these skills that were necessary for implementation of these six schemes that were laid out. So that's, I think, these are two specific questions to put together. Now, can we take this outside of Odisha? And I think there are, in the audience, there are very distinguished people from different states, and I think that would be a wonderful discussion to have. But let me flag a few things that sort of coming through in these kinds of things. The first is, I think, the essentially the USSRRC and the powers of the local ULB. I think the extent to which the political dispensation will allow that kind of power to go down to the city level and be exercised by a body like the USRRC is, I think, going to be a critical part of the story. I know from Amita's work in the smaller towns of Maharashtra that the political society is extremely strong. It would be useful to discuss the kind of benefits that were gained by this insulation and what would be lost if one allowed a greater political involvement, and what are the risks of doing that going forward. Because in many places, it may be difficult to limit the USRRC to the kind of composition that was possible to do in Odisha. The second, and I think this is also a core part of the issue, and to try and understand and unpack the Slum Dwellers Association. The immediate reaction of many people is that the Slum Dwellers Association would be captured by the elites within the slums, and how would you sort of ensure equity How do you ensure that minorities within the slums, I'm not talking necessarily of religious minorities, but any other forms of caste minority structures, are not somehow excluded? For example, Sai's work on a place like, for example, in Maharashtra, sort of shows that there were definitely exclusions as a result of these kinds of local level implementation mechanisms. So, no, did this happen? How was it prevented, etc., is one of the issues. And can you conceive of this as you're giving more and more of these associations? Can you conceive of these as a federation? In almost like you're thinking of a city mayor's association, or you're thinking of a federation of slum dwellers association to be able to put something in place. The kind of resources that were put into implementation, the doorstep survey, the drone settlements, this was one of the programs, I think, which was really strong on essentially putting the money and the resources and the time into planning before it actually went into execution. Will other states be able to do that? And how was Mr. Mathivatnan able to sort of ensure that this particular step got done so well, I think is an important learning to understand. And finally, I think the issues of, and this is a question that we might want to, it'll be an issue in many other cities. The big cities, my suspicion is, for the moment, are kept on hold because the real estate story there is different from the ones that you have seen in the other smaller cities. In many states across the country, the real estate story plays out at different scales. And so the question, therefore, is to ask is, in cities where land is become very much a commercialized commodity and a driver of local politics, what are the kinds of issues that are actually going to come? And in this, I think it would be useful to learn from Odisha's experience of what was the impact of this delinking of services from Delhi? Because we know from our experience in Delhi and in many other places across the country that it is the linking of services to tenure that prevents the provision of services to most informal settlements. And in Jaga too, the decision to delink service from tenure, I think is a very far-sighted decision. And it's important to try and understand what that means for both perceptions of tenure and therefore the pushback from a variety of people who might have otherwise been thinking of the land in a different way. So it's in these spaces that I see the transferability challenges to other states coming up. But I think there are lots of questions that I see on the chat box. So let me stop now.